We're back. The Neil Haley Show on the Total Celebrity segment, and I'm excited to welcome to the program Kristen Chenoweth. She is from NBC's Trial and Error Lady Killer Season 2. Kristen, thanks for calling. How are you?
I'm good. Thanks for having me, Neil.
Well, I'm excited to chat with you, and let's kind of, you know, just touch base and specifically enough your experiences with Wicked. My daughter, Ava, is such a huge fan of you from Wicked. How did you kind of transition from theater on Broadway on the way to now in on TV and stuff? That's a different transition, isn't it?
It is. And first of all, tell your girl, I said, thank you so much. That's always nice to hear when, you know, the younger generations like can appreciate you, right? It's just cool. I've always just been an actor, so I didn't really, it never really mattered to me whether it was on film or TV or on stage. If it's a good part, it's a good part, you know? And I don't really think about, oh, now I'm going to do TV or now I'm going to do, I just think about the role and I go, yeah, I want to do that, you know?
And that's the funny thing about it. You're right. You figure out the role and you become that character. How do you do that? Become that character, especially here you're 4'11". My wife's 5', and how do you, to become that character and become bigger than life on screen in certain ways based on your character?
Well, I will say that Lavinia, the character I play in A Lady Killer, is she is larger than life, and but she's been kind of lived a Grey Gardens type of existence for about 40 years. She's been locked away in her big, big mansion. She's the first lady of East Tech, and she's accused of murdering her husband. So, of course, she's horrified, and the town loves her. So there's lots of fun things to draw on. But, of course, when somebody is larger than life, you want to know what they're like in their private moments, too. And the writer, Jeff Astroff, gave me a lot of what you would call confessionals, where I just point blank talk to the camera. And in these moments, you really get a sense of who she is, I think. There's definitely a flair for the dramatic, but there's a lot of sadness in her and loneliness in her,
yes,
too.
When you're bigger than life, regardless, either power or fame, a lot of times you take advantage of the public. And it seems like she did do that, and it's hilarious. I watched the trailer for season 2, and it's just she's really funny. And just based on, we know those kind of people. So did you research those kind of people to prepare for this character?
Oh, please. I'm related to these kind of people. I grew up in the South. So there's a sense that you have in the South that you should always be, everything's under control. Stiff upper lip with a smile, you know? And I think that Lavinia has that a little bit, but I also feel that she's watched a lot of movies from the 30s and 40s era, and she's chosen to kind of talk like them, and she never learns anybody's name. Like her lawyer, she says, lawyer. She doesn't call him by his name. Other person, judge. You know, she just doesn't. The rules do not apply to Lavinia Peck Foster, and that was one of the most fun aspects of playing her.
Exactly. That seems like it's a fun character, and to think about that, so going back to the Deep South growing up in ways, figuring out that character, and we're going to learn throughout the season she's going to change, right? She's not going to always be the person she is, especially going through this whole process of being on trial.
Absolutely. The writer definitely gave the character a chance to, let's just say, appear and be very different from who we think she is. And of course, some would say, you know, is she a villain or is she loved? And that's the question I want the audience to ask throughout the entire season. And, you know, obviously I can't confirm or deny whether she's guilty or not, but if anybody watched The Jinx, you know, these documentaries about true crime are something that I really enjoy. And I believe that he very loosely based Lavinia on Robert Durst. So I've been inhaling these shows like Making of a Murderer and all these that have come out. And the way they shoot it in the documentary style, we call it mockumentary. And it is really, it's making fun of that type of show. And I just love it. It's hilarious.
Yeah, Kristen, watching like the ID channel investigation on Discovery and all these things and seeing how these murders are take place and what happens, and you get all into it, right? You could binge watch that all day, couldn't you?
Yeah. Just,
yeah.
You inhale it. Yeah, you can't get enough. I know that that's where I spend most of my time on TV at night when I can't sleep, I go immediately to the ID station. I'm like, I married a murderer. Who knew I married a murderer? I'm an axe murderer. I mean, it's just crazy.
And you never know how people change and happen, and then you're shocked to find out who the person is that does it and who done it. So that's right. So we're going to find out if that character of yours is the who done it, but she has the ego that she could care less if she did it, because she would be out of prison in seconds, right? Based on her lawyer and based on the thing. I like the funny scene where, again, your bail was only like $10 just because you're so well known in that town.
I know. And you know who pays it is the judge. That tells you how beloved she is.
And the prosecutor must be going crazy, right? And then there's just other comedy parts to it with the prosecutor and the relationship to your lawyer. It's funny. It really is. And it probably is a real life thing in ways that happen when you're in this business.
Well, you know, it's so funny when we watch, you know, these real crime dramas, we think you can't write this stuff. And this is real life. So what we've done is just turned it on its ear a little bit and make fun of it a little bit. And the cast, you know, John Lithgow told me to do the part. He said, we're all from the same planet. You're on this planet, girl. You've got to do it. And when I read the first script, I thought, oh, man, how am I going to negotiate for any money? I don't want the people to know how much I love it yet. You know, I really love it.
Well, it seems like you love it and you're really into it for sure. And connecting with the fans for sure is an important part of it as well, Kristen. You really stick to your fans, especially from as you have fans in Wicked and all the Broadway stuff you've done to your TV and movies. That it's all fun about the fans. That's what keeps shows running and keeps it exciting, doesn't it?
That's right. That's right. And really, I wanted to please John Lithgow, of course, because he set the bar so high. But I also want the fans to be on board and not be disappointed. You know, I don't think Lavinia Peck Foster is a disappointment. I think she is very different from Larry from season one. But I think she's, she's something. I'll just say that.
And then they'll be wanting more and more and more of you, Kristen. So the best place people can connect with you again, the season premiere is again on Thursday. Everyone needs to tune in. And where can we connect with you as well? Social media-wise.
Thank you so much for having me, Neil.
You're welcome. Social media, Kristen.
Have a good time. Tell your daughter I said hi.
Oh, I will. Thanks again for calling. Appreciate it. We're back to the Neil Haley Show on the Total Celebrity segment. I'm excited to welcome the program celebrity gossip expert Perez Hilton. Perez, thanks for calling. And I know you just talked about you're so excited. You're going to be heading to Vegas with your family. It's got to be awesome for the next, you said, 6 weeks. It's going to be a blast, isn't it?
I cannot wait for so many reasons. Like, I now am a Vegas headliner. It's a dream come true for me. I'm going to be starring in Chippendales as their special celebrity host from July 26th through Labor Day Sunday. And it just makes me happy for so many reasons. Like, I've seen the show before. I thoroughly enjoyed the show the two times I've seen it before. And also, I just love Vegas. I've been going to Vegas for 14 years. I have friends there. There's so much to do there. And people may not know this, but Vegas is really great for families. There's so much to do with kids there. And I got a lot of kids. I have a father of three now.
So, oh, my.
I'm going to be very busy in the evening with the show, wonderfully so, and then very busy during the daytime with my family.
And so it's interesting, Perez, how your life has changed in so many ways since the beginning. Question I had to ask is, how did you make yourself the celebrity gossip columnist? How did it happen? How did you become the guy? When anyone looks at specifically what's happening with gossip with celebrities, they think of Perez Hilton first. How did you do that?
Well, sure. I mean, when I speak to, and it actually, it's not even specific to college students or high school students. Like, older people could maybe learn something from this. But I would think maybe older people might know this already. But, you know, when I speak to young people, I let them know, when you're able to find what it is inside of you that's different and special and share that with the world, success will come to you. When you're able to do something new or do something in a different way, that will really help you get attention. And when I started doing what I was doing back in 2004,
holy cow,
nobody else doing it. There was no TMZ in 2004. People.com back in 2004 wasn't breaking celebrity news. All of the celebrity magazines were just using their websites to get subscriptions for the magazine. So I was doing something different, and people really started paying attention and enjoying it. And I'm so thankful now that 14 years later, I'm still around and getting to do cool things. Like, it seems like every year there's one really big, cool thing that I do outside of my day job. Last year, I was on the Food Network on a show for how many episodes? For 8 weeks, called Worst Cooks in America, Celebrity Edition, which I ended up winning. I was the best.
Oh, really? Wow.
And this year, I'm doing the Chippendales show, which I'm so excited to, because I got my degree in drama. I went to school at NYU and I studied acting. So any opportunity I have to be on stage, I take, and I love it. I'm so comfortable on there. And I'm excited also just to get to connect with what I think are my followers, because the Chippendales audience, even though they're very inclusive and everybody is welcome, you know, the two times I've seen it, the audience is like 95% female. And that's my audience too, overwhelmingly female. So I'm excited to connect with them, to connect with people that maybe I haven't connected with in a while, to connect with new people. It'll be super fun and just entertaining. I'm going to be entertained getting to watch the hot dudes do their thing.
So you spend time with the family, but then you kind of chill at night after the whole deal with kids. So let's talk about that, Perez. I want to jump to that really quick. You talked about, you gave one of the greatest quotes for sure about how to be a success, to basically be different than somebody else in some sort of way and go with it. And that's what you did. Now, you probably would have never thought when you talked about 14 years ago that now you'd have a family, three kids, taking them to Vegas, and then you headline at night. Kind of things that you like to do, spending time with family. Give us some of those things, Perez, because that doesn't come out always as a gossip columnist, your real personal life, Perez, at all. You only get into other people's personal lives.
My favorite thing to do with the family, and it's sort of one of the reasons why I love Las Vegas, like there's so many new things there just in the last few months. Like, Vegas is a lot like New York City, only smaller, which I love too. It's like this little strip, and it's like a human being. Like, it's constantly growing and evolving and changing. And I love doing new things. Like, when I go to Vegas, every time I go, I want to see, oh, what's the new restaurant that I should go eat at? Or what's the new club? Even though I'm not a club person, I like going to the big clubs just to see, because it's all so grand and opulent. And, oh, there's a pool in the middle of the club or whatever it is. Or look at this huge whatever thing they've got here. So in L.A., like, there's just so much to explore. And, you know, we have a car. It's easy to get around everywhere. Like just a couple of weeks ago, it's hard sometimes because, you know, both of my kids are in school. So, like,
right,
a lot
exactly.
of the weekends are, like, just birthday parties a lot of the time. But when we don't have a birthday party on a weekend, I like doing something different and new. Like, we went to go on a boat cruise and exploring San Pedro, which I'd never done before, and that was a lovely time. So I like doing little day trips and just making the most out of what Southern California has to offer.
Again, we're talking to Perez Hilton here on the Neil Haley Show about his, again, headlining in Vegas with the Chippendales, but also Perez's family life and all the fun things that are involved. What about you? I'm sure you get stressed out as well with your family like everyone else, so you're looking forward to times to kind of escape in Vegas, right, in certain ways to kind of chill out.
No idea.
I do for sure.
I'm stressed out all the time because I'm a single dad of three and a half. Not only my three kids, but I also take care of my mother who lives with us, and she also helps me take care of the kids too. So it's a great blessing, and I'm so thankful. But my life in Los Angeles is really busy, and in Vegas, it'll be less busy. Like, first, I won't have to take my kids to school every day.
Right.
Just taking them to school, because they're still in school during the summer, just summer camp. Just taking them to summer camp, because they're in two different schools, that's an hour and a half in the morning. And that's an hour and a half extra that I'm going to have every day now. I might allow myself to get a little more sleep and then just spend that more time with my family every day. Plus, also in LA, like, I'm constantly like, oh, I have to go to a meeting here. I have to go film something there. I have to go do this there. There won't be any of that. It'll just be me being able to focus on the show, putting on the best show possible every Thursday through Sunday night when I'm in it. They do a show 7 nights a week. Those boys work hard. And the nights that I have off, like, just making the most of those there with my friends, because I have friends that live in Vegas, and it's another reason why I love the city so much.
That's so awesome. And so it sounds like a really good time. So how people that are going to be in Vegas, you're going to headline, best place we can find information on you, Perez, and also this event, the events, and so that they can check you out when they're in Vegas, because everyone goes to Vegas at one point in time, especially for the time you'll be there. Where's the best place to find info and stuff? Where can they go?
Very simple to remember. Just go to chippendales.com. That's chippendales.com.
All right, Perez, and then everybody knows social media, Perez Hilton everywhere, and you can check him out everywhere, and thanks for calling, and I never knew about the family life, so that's an interesting story that you told. Enjoy your time in Vegas, and let's connect another time, all right?
All right, have a good one.
All right, take it, Perez. See you later. All right, bye-bye.
Thank you.
You're welcome, bye-bye. We're back to the Neil Haley Show on the Total Celebrity segment, and I'm excited to welcome the program comedian George Wallace. George, thanks for calling. How are you?
Thank you so much, and good morning to you and yours.
Absolutely, George. Now, I was looking at your bio, and to start out your career writing for Red Fox, tell us about that experience. What a legendary comedian. As yourself, you're a legendary comedian as well, but writing for the Red Fox show, that must have been an awesome experience, wasn't it?
Well, what an experience. When I first got to California, they asked me to write the show, and I thought it was awesome because Red Fox is the reason I'm in the business. Red Fox, Red Skelton, Red Button, and Pinky Lee, all of those comedians of color. That's why I'm in the business. Very funny. And it was just great to write the show. And I did it for a year, and then I started doing my own stand-up. And that's 40 years later, and I'm still having fun. And I tell you what's so great about having fun, being a comedian, working the same stage that Red Fox worked here in Las Vegas at the Westgate. It's just such an honor to have young people, old people, black people, white people, hip-hoppers, gangbangers. Everybody comes to the George Wallace IV Thinking Show at the Westgate in Las Vegas.
And that's phenomenal, George. And thinking about, you are a legendary comedian. It seems like you always want to be on stage from as a performer. 40 years, you said, of performing as a comedian. And this is just what you do. You love to do comedy, don't you?
It's the best thing in the world. And I teach that. I wrote a book called Laugh It Off. I teach people, make sure you enjoy your life. I wish everybody had a job like I have and you have. We just love to go to work. And when you honor your essence and just show people what you love to do, the money will come. I go out on stage every night for 1 hour. That's all I got to work is 1 hour. First of all, that's a good job right there. 1 hour a day, and they still pay you? That's wonderful. So you got to live your dreams and make sure you enjoy your life. Don't worry about the money. When you're enjoying life, the money will come.
And how powerful was it for your career as a comedian to get the Lifetime Achievement Award? That must have been so amazing in 2013.
Well, that was really amazing with all of the entertainers in the audience and people recognize you as being the top of your craft here. And like I said, you never know what's going to happen when you come to Las Vegas. Everybody comes to the George Wallace Show, from Jerry Seinfeld to Chris Rock, Chris Tucker, all of the great comedians, Kevin Hart, Aretha Franklin, Tom Jones. You never know what's going to happen at the George Wallace IV Thinking Show. And I tell you what, people that are listening, you can give them a pair of tickets. I give you the authority. When they come to Las Vegas, they can experience the George Wallace IV Thinking Show at the great new place, the Westgate Casino and Resort. You can do that.
Oh, thank you very much. Definitely. We'll definitely look into that for sure when any of my listeners all over the world decide to come to Vegas, because that's going to be your home, right, George? Where people are going to be able to see you every time in Vegas,
that's
right?
My home. I should be there for the next 2 years. The next 2 years when you come to Las Vegas is Wallace at the Westgate. Wallace at Westgate, and it's nothing but fun.
Now, when you said other comedians are going to join you, are you announcing that at certain times, or are they just going to show up when you talk about some of these famous comedians that you're friends with?
They just show up. That's why it's Vegas like it used to be. You never know what's going to happen at the show. Like I said, not only comedians, you got singers. Gladys Knight is always just stopping by. It's just a beautiful place to be. Barry Manilow comes over. It's just Bette Midler. Everybody comes to my show, and it's a lot of fun. And, of course, I put them on stage. And they just rock the place. So it's Vegas like it used to be. It's a lot of fun. We got the young rappers come in. It's just great. Got a rapper coming in by the name of Waka Flocka Flame. He's coming to Las Vegas. Waka Flocka Flame. And I don't cuss. You never hear me cuss, but that name, Waka Flocka, that's my new cuss word. So you have a lot of fun when you come to the show.
When you think about the history.
You can't use that joke, Waka Flocka. It's not cursing. But it sounds good, doesn't it?
So, George, why don't you...
And I said, look at this Waka Flocka up in here.
When you talk about African-American comedians and you don't cuss, why don't you, George? Think about the ones, the legendary ones that you worked with from, you know, you brought up, and they do. And especially in comedy, when everyone was trying to break in about the same time you were, African-Americans, some of them were a bit dirty. Why have you chosen not to go that route?
Well, they had as many clean African. It's not African comedians. It's just comedians in general. It's not just African Americans. It's everybody. People are free to use the freedom of speech to use any word they want to use now. And that's good because of HBO. When I started, the outlets were only ABC, CBS, and ABC, CBS and NBC. But now they have HBO. You got Hulu. You got everything. You got Netflix. And you can say what you want to say, which I think is good. I just happen to be clean. It's harder to be clean, but... funny is funny. Nobody did it better than Richard Pryor. It's just good to do, just be you. You know, you got some, Sam Kinison, he wasn't clean. He did a good job. And so many people, it's just be you. I'm a clean comedian, but I find ways to say anything I want to say without cursing. I can out-cuss anybody on stage.
I'm sure.
I just don't do it on stage a lot.
I see, George. No, I was talking about the African-Americans at the time of breaking in. I know everyone. Remember when they had the history of comedy on CNN and they talked about, you know, the specifics of people being pulled off stage for certain jokes and certain things. You saw that history of comedy for whoever the comedian was to try to get their free speech out there. So you like the way it is today, but it was challenging then, right? Especially what jokes you can say and what you could do.
It was challenging. Of course, Lenny Bruce had a hard time. He was kicked out. Richard Pryor was kicked out. So many of the older comedians were kicked out, but they called it blue humor back in the day. But everybody liked it. You know, when we were kids, we used to listen to the blue humor. Our parents owned the albums, those big albums. They called them party records back in the day. So everybody's always cussed, and they were very popular. But now it became PC. That's what's happening now. I don't do a PC show. I talk about anybody and everybody. If you do it right, it can be funny. And that's what I do. Funny is funny.
And you see, George, the PC way is the way that some comedians, if they don't go PC, get in a lot of trouble. And that's too bad as well, right? Especially as you are a comedian. And what can you say and not say?
That's very bad. Some comedians, such as my best friend Jerry Seinfeld, he doesn't like to do colleges because everybody's PC. If you say this about somebody, if you say that about somebody, everybody gets upset. I don't. It's the way you present the package. Like I had a blind lady that come to my show. She was blind, and she came in late. And I chewed her out for coming in late. I said to the blind lady, how the hell you coming here late? You got somebody to lead and guide you around. I said to the blind lady, look at all these other people in this audience. And people went crazy, and the blind lady went crazy. We all laughed. If you do it right, you can see it.
And that's such an amazing thing. So, George, I'm invited, if I'm ever in Vegas, to come to your show then, right? Whenever I'm in Vegas.
You can do that, and you can give it. I'll tell you what, you are so good, and you have such a large audience. You can give away 5 pairs of tickets. How about that? To come see George Wallace at the Westgate.
All right, well, I appreciate it. So we got to check you out. And best place social media-wise, George, to connect with you. Where can we go? On social. Where are you on social?
You go to Twitter at Mr. George Wallace. Do that. Twitter at Mr. George Wallace. I was voted one of the top 25 funniest tweeters by Rolling Stone magazine. So we do have fun. That's George Wallace at Mr. George Wallace on the Twitter account. Do that.
All right, congratulations, George. Best of luck in Vegas and your new home. And I look forward to meeting you someday, okay?
I love you, and there's absolutely nothing you can do about it.
All right, take care, George. Thanks. All right, bye-bye. We're back to Neil Haley's show on the Total Celebrity segment, and I'm excited to welcome the program. I guess it's an anniversary of anniversary, so he's excited to be chatting about it. Ari Melber from The Beat on MSNBC. How are you, Ari? And you got to be excited about this anniversary, right? 1 year. You can't believe it's happened that quickly, right?
I'm great, thank you, and very excited to mark today's 1 year of The Beat on the air. And yeah, it does fly by, even though that's a cliche. It's been quite a news year.
It has been quite a news year for sure, Ari. And it's the perfect, like, to put yourself out there and think that you never know what you're going to talk about, especially politically. To say to yourself, really, did President Trump do this? Did seriously somebody do this? It's not hard to find material, is there?
No, and we're in an environment where I think the president is challenging everyone, and that's his nature. The country is taking this all in and figuring out what we've learned about ourselves, not just Donald Trump, but what do we want to do about it? And a lot of those issues are in news, politics, and law, which is sort of our sweet spot.
Exactly. So tell us a little bit about your show in a way that's a little different. It's interesting at the time slot because it's an hour show, and then, you know, there's news all the time, but you're taking a different perspective in the news for your hour, aren't you?
Yeah, I mean, what we're trying to do on The Beat is be a show where you can come and get the top news story no matter what. And we've seen our viewership grow now to about 1.3 million nightly viewers, which is more than any show in the history of our time slot and a lot more than any hour of CNN, so at 6 or later. So we're seeing the audience come to us, which has got to be some kind of good sign, and that's because at the top you get the straight news stories no matter what, full, fair, objective, thoughtful. Yes, last week we had all this Michael Cohen news, Donald Trump's former lawyer. We had on Jay Goldberg, who was Trump's main lawyer before Michael Cohen. He was the guy before Mike.
Oh, wow.
And so he knows Michael. He knows the president. He brings that perspective. We also had on other people, including some critics of the president. So my view is no matter who you are, where you are in the country, we're going to give you that. You're going to learn more and have more from that. Then as the hour goes on, we really broaden out. We hit other stories. We do some deeper reports. I mean, the other week we did a big deep dive on what Betsy DeVos is doing in the education department. Now, there's nothing that night that demands we do that story, and you might not see it on any other show.
That's great.
But education matters. If you got kids in school, you got a whole thing of let's put the tweets aside and look at what's going on. And then we do some culture and fun stuff. Last night we had on David Diggs and his co-star from this new movie. David Diggs is a major figure because he played Thomas Jefferson in Hamilton, which people probably heard about, was one of those big
Absolutely,
hits.
Yeah.
And now he's got a new film, and we're talking about that and police and news stories. So we're trying to bring the culture in as well when we can.
Again, we're talking to Ari Melber here on The Neil Haley Show. And let's talk about Betsy DeVos for a second. I have an education show as well, Ari, that's just straight education on my syndication. And really, this is the biggest upsetting thing. I am a conservative that just cannot stand Betsy DeVos because I'm a former teacher and I have a tutoring and consulting company. And that I'm so glad you covered that because literally we don't know what's happening to the U.S. Department of Education is an absolute shame, isn't it? What's happening and how they're looking to merge it with the Labor Department and all that. It's just awful.
Well, there's a lot of questions about what she's bringing to that department. And look, I think it's understandable that many Americans, including a lot of conservative Americans, say, well, why can't we bring, you know, certain insights or leadership from business into the government? And I think the question is, what are the actual plans and how does it benefit people and what are the metrics for success? And so in Donald Trump, you know, you've got a guy who's put a lot of rich people in the cabinet, but it hasn't always worked out that well. And I think Betsy DeVos, you know, by her own admission said, well, they haven't really figured out how to visit the lower performing schools and make sure they're improving, and that's not really what she's interested in. Well, you know, I got news for you. If you're the Secretary of Education for America, you need to be about all the schools, not
exactly
just some of them. And so I think she's run into a lot of trouble for that, and it doesn't mean that you can't bring new ideas or business into the administration. I think it's more complex, but we tried to shine a light on sort of what she's really doing.
Again, we're talking to Ari Melber of MSNBC here on The Neil Haley Show. And when I talk about specifically enough, Ari, the process of Betsy DeVos, Betsy has an idea that she thinks will work like business. You know, when we're in business, we look at specifically results. education's very difficult to compare one school to the next school. It's very difficult to compare one teacher to the other teacher. And I don't think she understands how challenging it is to be a teacher and what baggage comes from other schools. We can have success, but it's not a fair playing field when we talk about charter schools, school vouchers versus public education where there's no funding.
Right. And I think the voucher discussion can work if it's a discussion about an option among many. I think the claim that you're going to voucherize everything or turn everything into charter schools doesn't really wash, because we've seen the neighborhoods and the places where charter schools are experimented with can work if there's enough funding. But I don't know what it means to say, well, all of America is going to run on charter schools. That's not really very viable, at least right now.
So, Ari, basically on that front, what do you think in certain aspects needs to change in education? Because it's very hard. Is it training better teachers? Is it looking at administrators? Or really looking at specifically making it a fair playing field with all school choice? Not just, well, you know, certain people have better opportunities because they're handpicked in certain ways.
Well, I mean, I wouldn't hold myself out as being able to solve this riddle. I mean, part of what we do on the show is interview people, bring on experts, try to expose and reveal things. But I'm not sort of floating here as a philosopher king. I mean, in my own experience, I went to a public high school in Seattle that was a magnet school, and it had a lot of good things in the sense that it had great programs, a great diversity, great sports, great extracurriculars. So it was one of those public schools that in many ways was working. And we had national merit scholars, competitive with the state, and all that kind of stuff. But we also had problems of an inner-city school. We had a shooting inside the school. No one was killed, but two people were shot during school hours. And so I kind of feel like I came up through that with a deep appreciation for how complex it is. And in that school, just by example, if you only ran it by, you know, testing, you'd only have a very narrow slice of what was going on at the school, the good and the bad. Those are the kind of experiences I bring to it. But as a host of a news show, I wouldn't hold myself out as ready to give out, you know, solutions to what is a big crisis, you know?
Well, Ari, you have to have me on the show. I could definitely provide that education portion of the expertise when it comes whenever you have another education topic, because of the experience of covering education for 9 years, being a teacher myself in the classroom, also doing supervision. And really the fact of the matter is, when it comes to education, you cannot compare school districts because of money. You cannot compare specifically teachers. You have to look at evaluating each teacher individually, evaluating each student individually, because it's not something like business where you can look at the bottom line. Until people figure that out, I can spot a good teacher from the bad teacher by walking into the classroom. And there's a lot of different areas of where success comes as a teacher. And guess what? They could be a great teacher, but their kids might not perform well on tests. That's the real truth to the matter.
Right. Right.
Yeah, so that's for sure. All right, Ari, everyone needs to check you out, right? MSNBC every night, 6 p.m. Eastern, right?
6 p.m. Eastern, and you can find me online at Ari Melber, Arimelber, at Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, all that stuff. And I appreciate you having me on, and appreciate the policy conversation, sir.
I enjoyed it, and I definitely love to do it again, and thanks again for calling. Appreciate it. We're back to Neil Haley's show on the Total Celebrity segment, and I'm excited to welcome the program from the Today Show, Al Roker. Al, thanks for calling. Always love to chat with you, and how are you today?
I'm doing great, Neil. Thank you so much for asking.
Absolutely. Let's kind of jump really quickly, a really interesting thing, Al, about preparation for the Today Show. Myself, being a very smaller host than you are, in meaning reach-wise compared to yourself, tell us the preparation every day to do the Today Show. What time does your day start?
Well, my day starts about 3:45. I get up. I take care of my toilet, and then I'm on the phone with my meteorologist. I mean, we're both looking at a computer, we're on the internet, we're looking at notes, we're looking at maps, we're looking at the models, trying to figure out, okay, what are we going to do? I mean, I actually, before I even go to bed the night before, I'm on the phone with them, and here's what I think I think is going to be the big story. What do you think? And we basically just kind of compare notes. So I do that for about 45 minutes, and then I'm out the door at about 5:20, 5:30. I'm at the studio by 5:45, and boom, we hang out, we do whatever, we get ready, and next it's time we do the show for 2 hours.
That's amazing, Al. And what time do you go to bed if you have to get up so early?
Well, you know, I keep saying I'm going to get to bed on time. I'm going to get to bed by 9, and it ends up being like 9:30, 10 o'clock. I don't get enough sleep.
But good thing is that you exercise, stay healthy, and that's the important thing, Al, that you can survive those kind of some night and then catch up on the weekends. That's pretty much what you do, I'm sure. You're pretty exhausted
on
the weekends.
That's what you try to do, although they tell you can't make up that sleep, but, you know, you do what you can.
I think it's when you're living your passion, it's important. So now, again, we're talking to Al Roker. We're going to talk about Hallmark movies and mysteries and the morning show mystery, Murder on the Menu. Wow, Al, this seems really, really interesting. And tell us how this is this connection to this and the idea. Because, again, the murder mystery is just really, really popular for sure, on murder show mystery on Hallmark.
Well, you know, the Hallmark Movies and Mysteries channel is like one of the fastest growing channels out there. And what's fun is that we basically get to take this genre and make it fun again. You know, it's not so grisly, it's not so grim. It's a throwback maybe to Matlock or Murder, She Wrote. And in this one of the characters I created, Billy Blessing, who's a chef and also a morning show host, is played by Holly Robinson Pete. In the first one, about a few months ago, she was accused of murder and had to, you know, help crack the crime. This one of her rival chefs, a big hotshot 4-star chef, comes to town and is accused of murder and actually turns to his competitor, Billy Blessing, to help clear him. And in the meantime, she's trying to navigate her relationship with this detective that she used to date, who is now a murder detective. A homicide detective. And so, will they or won't they? That's one of the mysteries as well.
Well, definitely, for sure. And this is based on your book as well, right, Al? So this is what's exciting about getting to see the book go on to a film. Yeah.
Three mysteries. So this is kind of fun. And when it airs at 9 p.m. Eastern on Sunday on Hallmark Movies and Mysteries, all of us will be live tweeting alongside our viewers. So the hashtag will be Morning Show Mystery, and we'll tweet along with you.
See, that's so cool. And I think you're getting with it, aren't you, Al? The live tweeting now? There you go, right? You're seeing how important it is to connect with those fans.
Love the social media.
Yeah. It's a
trying to be we're on the Twitter like the young kids.
And you're like, okay. And then what's awesome is the fans of Hallmark. I've interviewed so many celebrities that have come on about Hallmark movies. And isn't it amazing? Think about their whole Christmas thing. It's going to be amazing. But the fan base that's building in Hallmark is just unbelievable, and the growth of the channel and how, you know, families stay connected and really love these movies.
Yeah, that's what really is great about it, because the whole family can watch. And that's very important, I think, in these days. And I think that's why Hallmark is doing so well, because, you know, in this day and age of families being disconnected and people all on their individual phones and iPads and whatever devices, here's something that brings everybody together. And that's a great thing.
We're talking again to Al Roker about his morning show mystery, Murder on the Menu, on the Hallmark Channel. It'll premiere again Sunday, July 22nd at 9 p.m. Eastern. And we're on the Neil Haley Show with Al. And Al, what made you want to write something like this? How do you have the time? You're talking about your crazy schedule. When do you have time to write books? That's the thing. And we know you crank out a lot of books, too. You must be very structured and scheduled.
You know, it's funny you say that, because I'm really not, but I, you know, I travel a lot. I have, you know, I do have downtime. I find whenever I have that time, like the last several books I've written on iPads. I haven't written on a traditional laptop. You know, I spend a lot of time in airports and on airplanes or on trains. And so that's when I do a lot of my writing. But I think I love writing. I love reading. And so those two passions kind of came together.
Oh, that's awesome. And it's something that you put that together. And instead of like watching television all the time or wasting time, you make sure when you have time to write, it sounds like. This is your passion, isn't it, Al?
Yes, it is. But let me also tell you, as somebody who does make their money on television, I never think watching television is a waste of time. Television is one of the greatest pastimes ever created, especially live morning TV.
And no, I didn't say waste of time on TV, Al. I said waste of time,
no,
other
I'm
wasting
just,
time. I know.
You got
to make your living. You got to say television's still alive, and we know. And that's one thing that's great, Al, is television's never going to die. And how internet radio is becoming popular and podcasting's becoming popular, television will never die because you see the real live person face to face. And it'll always be like you're coming in their living room. For sure. And that's what the power of TV is.
And if it's going to die, I'll be the guy to kill it.
I don't think so, Al. You're an amazing person. And I'm looking towards when are we going to have a memoir out, unless you've written a memoir already or a continued memoir, because your story is just unbelievable of what you've done in your career and how you continue to progress.
That. Yeah. Thank you, Neil. I really do appreciate it.
You're welcome. We know we can connect Al Roker on all social media channels, and everyone needs to tune in on Sunday, right? Sunday, July 22nd, 9 p.m. Eastern, to the Hallmark Channel to check out your movie. So, Al, thanks for calling, and I appreciate you coming on.
Sunday, Hallmark Movies and Mysteries.
You're ready to do that. Hey, you're ready to be an announcer, too. It's voiceovers everything, Al. It's all you. You're the jack of all trades. Thanks for calling, Al. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Take care. Bye-bye. You're listening to Neil Haley Show, and we'll be back in just a moment. We're back to the Neil Haley Show on the Author's Corner segment, and I love talking to this guy, especially talking education, talking politics, and all these different things, so I'm excited to welcome the program. Michael Eric Dyson, he's the author of What Truth Sounds Like, Robert F. Kennedy, James Baldwin, and Our Unfinished Conversation About Race in America. Michael, thanks for calling. How are you?
Thanks, man. Thanks for having me on. I'm great, and it's great to be on to talk to you.
Absolutely. Let's go right into the whole RFK movement. I'm learning more and more about RFK with this anniversary of his assassination, and I'm learning more and more how amazing his and transformative and how he was really looking to talk about things that should have been spoken that are now in the news right now, meaning he really wanted to unite people with race and everything. And he had such great ideas, didn't he?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, he was committed to changing his mind, to evolving, to growing. Not many politicians can say they can do the same. Listen to people, talk to people, hear them out before you speak. Study an issue well before you articulate your views on it. And he was willing to do that. Now, he didn't start that way. He was, you know, he had a big temper, and he was upset by things. And the meeting that I write about in this book kind of pissed him off. But to his credit, he could hear people, learn from them. And even after he got upset, he would calm down and say, you know what? They got a point. Let me address my own deficit. Let me think about how I think about race. It's not just a political problem. It's a moral one, too. That's what the people meeting with him wanted him to understand, and his brother, who was the president of the United States of America. Let me figure out a way to address these issues, not only politically, but morally. And let me, as a white man, become much more sensitive and sensible and empathetic to others. And it changed American politics because he was able to become one of, if not the most trusted white men in America when it came to issues of race, because he was willing to honestly and openly address them in ways that many white politicians were not willing to do.
Absolutely. That's so true, Michael. That's the thing. He was able to address those issues. And looking at JFK, who is really renowned and known and helped in this race relations in certain ways, he used it in a different way, didn't he, JFK? He used it as a way politically to help himself. Well, it seems like RFK really felt it more in his heart to help in this process.
Yeah, that's a good point. I think JFK was a political master in terms of trying to do the least possible in order to get the biggest effect. And he didn't want to outrage the white supremacists who were on one hand and, you know, who were against real progress, racially speaking. And on the other hand, he didn't want to totally alienate black people who had been critical in getting him elected. He had placed a well-timed call to Martin Luther King Jr.'s jailer in Georgia, got him out of jail. And when that word got around the nation, especially black communities, black people who could vote, voted for Kennedy overwhelmingly and got him elected. So Kennedy was more of a strategist and tactician who was trying to figure out a way to avoid the consequences of whatever burgeoning racial beliefs he had, whereas Robert Kennedy didn't have the demands of the highest office in the land and was more open to trying to figure out ways to address race in symbolic gesture as well as substantive politics that could make a difference.
And that's very interesting. And he learned from this, right, Michael? Who would you say were the people that influenced him into this stance and influenced him to go this direction?
Yeah, no, it's a great point. Well, that meeting was extremely important. You know, they weren't the only people, but look who was there. James Baldwin, the great writer, Harry Belafonte, who was already a friend of his, who was the great singer, the first American artist to sell 1 million records, and as an LP, 1 million albums. And so, you know, Lena Horne was there, the great singer, Lorraine Hansberry, the great artist, and Jerome Smith, an activist. So these people really got to Kennedy that day. Made him mad at first because he was trying to figure out why black people were being attracted to the black Muslims
right,
and others
right, right.
Spoke about black rage because black rage was real. It wasn't being addressed. And so they got into a bit of a battle, a contretemps, a sustained dialogue that ended up being a beatdown of Kennedy. And to his credit, he didn't get up and leave. He listened, even though he was pissed. And at the end of that meeting, he sicked the FBI on many of the people who were there. He developed dossiers of many of the people trying to figure out what their deal was. But after he calmed down, he said, look, if I were born black in America, I'd be full of rage too and angry and acting like Jerome Smith was at that meeting, who was tired and fed up with some of the things that were being said by white liberals to black people. And it really changed his outlook and mind. He said, yep, race is a political issue, but a moral one as well. As these young people, as these artists and activists are telling me, and I got to change my perspective on that and get the president to change his perspective, which he did. He got the president to deliver his June 1963 speech on race that pretty significant, addressing in part James Meredith, who was trying to get into the University of Mississippi, Ole Miss, and got shot along the way on his one-man trek, and then it was taken up his campaign by Martin Luther King Jr. and others, but the president addressed it as a moral, not just a political issue. And then Kennedy himself became much more empathetic to black people. And by the time of his death, 5 years later, became one of, if not the most sympathetic and well-trusted, most trusted white man in black America.
Very, very interesting. And that influence and that meeting and that, what has been the feedback, Michael, so far when you've researched that and found out about that meeting more and more, how they influenced RFK and how that's transformed our society today? But again, we're going backwards, but meaning before certain things, when we're seeing some amazing things happening. What has the feedback been in your book from people reading it and also other people knowing that you wrote about this that were like colleagues of yours and other people?
Yeah. They're surprised about the meeting, man. That's a good thing when you're an author and then people go, I didn't know about this meeting. Ding! You know, mission accomplished. I did something that people didn't know about. I presented an idea to them that they weren't familiar with, or a meeting that they didn't know about. So, you know, that was gratifying. And then people have been impressed with, you know, how Kennedy evolved over space and time. They like what I've done in terms of, I looked at all the major groups of people who were there, activists, artists, intellectuals, you know, who were trying to make a difference in the world. And I write about them, and I throw in a chapter about athletes who have made a significant difference in our lives. So, you know, people think it's well written. I appreciate that. It's been getting great reviews and responses from people who read it, who say they didn't know about this meeting, and they're grateful to have a book that addresses
That's
it.
Great.
And so my mission is accomplished.
I see. I didn't know this. And then someone else wrote a biography on RFK, that Robert F. Kennedy. And I interviewed him a couple months ago. And then someone else talked about, you know, the meeting of someone wrote from the Washington Post and a couple other op-eds about the flight with the and brought up RFK again. And none of this, I didn't know. And they all talked about how transformative the guy is. And Michael, you found it out. That shows how much of an historian you are, a researcher you are. And now we could see how today we can do the same things. Somebody like yourself and other people in the Black community need to meet with specific politicians and change their mind, especially with this whole meeting with President Trump and Putin that has really destroyed our country in a lot of ways with the media. Somebody like yourself and other leaders need to get together with certain politicians to make them understand, because we need a transformative mind to move forward in the 21st century to change what's happening today.
No doubt about it. Couldn't be better stated. I agree with you. That's why I wrote this book, to try to figure out how we could make a contribution toward that end. And that's what I'm trying to do.
Well, that's fantastic. And that's what we definitely have to, people have to check you out and find all that different information. So where can they purchase the book, Michael? Where's the best place?
The local bookstores, independent chains, Barnes & Noble, and Amazon.com. Check it out, my man.
And what about social media-wise? Where can we connect with you, Michael?
Michael E. Dyson on Twitter and everything else, Facebook and Instagram, Micah.
All right, fantastic. And, Michael, one more question. Education. What do you think how RFK transformed education, would you say, for the race relations? What do you think he did in that area?
Well, he showed that it was important for us to be educated about these issues of race and to talk seriously and deeply and profoundly about what happens in America when people have access to education. And RFK fought for the ability of Black people to be able to have and enjoy that education and to make certain that they were able to get, you know, educated to the same degree that white people were in this country, that if you have these big suburban schools that have all this tremendous resource and yet incapable, that the inner cities are incapable of having the same kind of resource level, we got to figure out a way to really bridge that disparity and figure out how we can support education among African-American Latinos and other people in this country.
All right, Michael, thanks for calling. Best of luck, and thanks for coming on the show. Appreciate the conversation. Take care. You're listening
to
Neil Hill.
Thanks for having me,
You're welcome.
Friend.
You're welcome. Take care. Bye-bye.